I asked three of my professors to write a recommendation letter for me. I knew that I wanted to get a professor who can speak to my strengths in different settings.
I actually asked three faculty members in the CSD department. They really just knew me the best because I had several classes with each of them, and I overall just had the closest relationships with them.
I asked my professor who I worked with research on. I was her research assistant, so that was a professor that I asked. I also asked my neuro professor, who's also my anatomy physiology professor as well. And I also asked my advisor, who was also my supervisor, for a job that I had, and also was a professor for multiple classes that I had as well.
So I asked for my letters of recommendation early in the fall semester of my senior year. I also gave them my final grade in the class in case they didn't have that on hand, and any due dates for the letters. For the professors, I generally wrote a very similar email, sort of outlining those major points. But for the research professor, I was able to talk with her more casually about it and express to her, you know, I wanted her letter to reflect more of my research goals, my work as a research assistant, and more about my work ethic.
I asked in person because I felt like it's such a huge favor to ask and I wanted it to be more personal. So I asked them in person, but I did make sure to send them a follow-up email just so they remember, because if you think about it, there's one professor and many students, right? So you want to make sure that they remember that you asked for a recommendation letter.
Fall semester of senior year. And so how I went about that process was that for the professors who were available in person to meet, I asked them in person. I set up an office hour appointment with them, and then I followed up after the meeting with an email to just briefly review what we talked about and to also give more information. For the professors who weren't available in person, I emailed them with kind of an introduction in terms of laying out, you know, how I know them and kind of my relationship to them, and then asking, basically politely asking, like, you would be a great recommendation, and if you are willing to do so.
So most applications are due in the sort of December or January range. And as a result of that, most students will ask for their letters of recommendation near the beginning of the fall semester. So that's approximately in the September to October timeline. For me, it's best if students ask for the letter over email. They may have also asked me for the letter in person or after class, but it's good for me to have an official request over email because then I have documentation that somebody has asked me for a letter, and I can save it into a folder where I put all of my other requests, and then I can go through it in a more systematic way.
When you ask for the letter of recommendation, if you can tell the letter writer why you think you want a letter from them, then that might help your case. So for instance, if you say, you know, my performance in your class is really representative of my potential, I'd love for you to speak to that in this letter. That's really helpful for the recommender.
I think that the way that you ask that faculty member or professor is sort of dependent on the history you have with that person. So if you work in their lab and you see them on a regular basis, you should probably ask them in person. But if email is the way that you usually exchange information, then email is the way to go. I prefer asking students to give me a reminder a week before it's due in case it's fallen off my radar. The last thing I ever want to do is be the reason for a late submission.
So I believe it's helpful to ask for a recommendation after completing a personal essay, or at least have a draft of the essay, or at least bullet points of what I plan to discuss in my personal essay, because some professors asked for either the personal essay or for bullet points. And even if they do not ask, it was always good to provide them with the information, to provide them with a sample or a draft of the personal essay so that they can get to know your application as a whole. So it's also important to know the information that the application requires, such as the deadlines, how to submit, and anything the professor needs.
One of the professors asked me for a list of bullet points of why I think I did what I did and how I think my qualities carry through. I think that was actually very useful for me. I think I would recommend it even if you aren't looking for a letter of recommendation, because it got me thinking about what I did and how I can portray myself through, and in what she asked for bullet points, but also in my essays for the various schools. It was very helpful for me during the application process.
What I usually want and what I ask for is for students to write me a bulleted list of what they think sets them apart. And this is a time I tell them not to be shy. I want to know everything they think makes them a great candidate for graduate school.
I think it's really helpful if you remind the professor which course and which semester you took the class in. That's so that we can go back and look at your performance. And I like to actually provide in the reference letter, details about your performance and which assignments and how you did compared to the rest of the class. So it's really helpful to have that information at the outset.
It's useful for them to have the details in your CV or resume. It's also useful for them to know your sort of your transcript. If you are applying to a school that requires GRE still, to have that kind of information, and really just to know sort of how you're going to sort of if you're saying in your application, you know, I'm really interested in this part of this program or that part of the program, it's useful for your letter writers to know that as well, so they can say that you'd be a really good fit for that particular thing.
And any information about themselves that would help me write the best letter that I can. So that might be sending a draft of your personal statement, sending your CV or resume, and any other helpful information that isn't on those documents or anything that you would want me to highlight in a letter. So often a student will send some extra information along with their request for a letter, and I'll find out that they won some wonderful award that I didn't know about, and I can incorporate that into my letter. So that's really helpful.
Yeah, I believe I waived my right. It was just something that everyone said to do, so that's why I did it.
Yes, I did waive the right to view the letter. I trusted all my wonderful professors who wrote the letters for me, and I didn't really feel the need to view the letter after it was written. So yes, I waived my right.
Waiving your right to view the letter indicates that you're confident in the positive nature of the review, your relationship with whoever you are that you are asking, and it also allows the letter to hold more weight for the application review team when it reaches their office.
And I think it overall just shows that you have trust in who you asked to write your letters, and that you do have that relationship where you're not worried about what they will write or anything along those lines.
It's customary for students to waive their right to view the letter of recommendation. There's really no benefit to not waiving that. And there are definitely universities that that would really prefer to see that students are willing to waive that right. And so that's a box that I would definitely recommend that you check.
When you waive your right to view the letter of recommendation, you are telling both your letter writer and the application reviewer that you are confident that the person who's written your letter knows you well and is going to speak highly of you and highly of your skills.
When a student selects the option to view the letter before it's submitted, it's difficult for faculty to feel like they can be completely transparent. So sometimes it looks like a red flag when a candidate does not waive their right to view the letter of reference. So those references should be confidential, and I prefer to see students waive their right to that.
So we want to see evidence that you are going to be successful in your next academic endeavor with us as a graduate student in speech language pathology. If you've been out of school for a little while, more than 5 years, you may replace your academic letters of reference with professional letters of reference or professional letters of recommendation. So those are typically people that you've worked for. Ideally, those are going to come from your employer or your supervisor.
If you're coming from a non-SLP or CSD or related background, or you don't have clinical experiences, that's okay. What I want to see your letter writer write is that you have transferable skills, that the skills that you displayed in this environment or in this experience can be readily applied to speech pathology. That is just as good as someone who has speech pathology experience and has demonstrated aptitude in that arena.
Another thing to consider is that person's experience in writing letters of recommendation. So professors are very experienced writing letters of recommendation. We do this all the time. But I've seen a lot of letters of recommendation which are from people who are not in an academic context, so people in a work environment, and they might write a letter that's really only two or three sentences. And even if it's positive, it's a real missed opportunity for the applicant.
Many schools will actually request that you definitely have one letter writer from an academic background. So what this means essentially is somebody who's been your professor in multiple classes or somebody who you've worked in your lab. What you probably want to consider the most is somebody who really knows you the best. Somebody who can say, you know, this is a really great applicant who would make a really strong student and can then support that with some interactions that they've had with you that really demonstrate that you would be a great fit for whichever programs you're applying to.
I think that it's helpful if the letter writer talks about the student's strengths, certainly, but also their weaknesses. No student is perfect, and it can help to know something about what areas of growth you see for that person. So it's not a bad thing if the letter talks about weaknesses. In fact, that can be a positive thing. It tells me that the letter writer is taking the task seriously, is being honest, and can provide a good balance of both strengths and weaknesses for the applicant.